Yeah, let's go.
Blessings and welcome to another pastoral teaching on this chilly Wednesday night. And we thank God that we have the opportunity to share via these means. And so nobody has to get out in the cold, but we're able to hear the word of God right where we are. And so we thank you so much for all of you that you continue to see this broadcasting as a viable source of spiritual nourishment for yourselves and your family. So as is our custom, as you're coming in tonight, greet your neighbor. Let somebody know that you are excited to see them in the cyber sanctuary tonight. The Lord has kept us all the way to Wednesday. And so it's time to testify and tell somebody of the goodness of God in these days since we have last communicated with each other. So let somebody know that you're excited to see them tonight. Also, do your part in digital evangelism. Like and share. Somebody really needs to hear this word tonight. All right. And so I want you to take this time now to share this with your circle just by clicking that share button. Everybody that's connected to you will have an opportunity to get what you are getting. And we can't make anybody receive it, but at least we can put it where they can get it. So tonight, like and share and help us to get the word out. All right. We're not going to prolong the time at all tonight. We're going to get right into the word of God. I'm excited about what we have, and I don't want to hold you too long, but I want to make sure that I give you what the Lord has given to me. So as we're preparing to get started tonight, let us pray God's blessings on our time together. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for these, your people. God, you have kept us all the way to Wednesday. And we say thank you, looking forward to what you're going to do on the second half of this week. And so tonight, God, I pray, God, that every distraction be bound. And I pray, God, that your people be connected intimately and intensely to your word. And I pray, God, that you give me articulation of speech tonight to communicate your word with excellence, accuracy, and boldness. And we thank you, God, that we will receive this, take this with us, apply it to our lives, and be better for it. And we give your name glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Tonight, we're going to get right into this. And I want to start right out of the gate. I have to give you something that the Lord gave me just this week to really help to guide our understanding of why we're doing what we're doing and why we have to take this to the next level. And very, very simply, the Lord said to me that my people are trying to live off of lectures. Is what he said. My people are trying to live off of lectures. And to clarify that, or to make that live for me, to give me an understanding of what he meant, he took me back to my college days. And all of my college students, those of you many times in high schools, they use the same format. But many times when I was in college, y'all, I would walk into the classroom and the teacher would come in. If the class started at 6, the teacher would walk in at 6 o'clock. And at 6 o'clock, or they walk in a little before 6, and right at 6 o'clock, they would just start teaching. They would just start with the lecture, right? And the teacher, you could tell that the teacher was prepared because the teacher had put together a lesson plan, and they took small incremental portions and pieces of that book, put it together for that lecture for that night. They were knowledgeable of the subject matter, and we all had the exact same book, right? And so the teacher would come into class and start teaching. And then it was our responsibility to come to class, number one, but then to take notes in class based on what the teacher said, because the notes many times would give us insight into other questions we may have had, or just nuggets or things to take with us to help us understand the subject matter. Stay with me. And so when the class was over, the teacher would say, now, read chapter such and such through chapter such and such. Here is the homework. Here is the due date. And then they leave. That's it. And then it was on the student to go home, read the chapters, do the homework necessary in order to do to pass the class. So when the Lord said to me that my people are trying to live off lectures, here's what he gave to me. And that is that many of us come to church on Sunday, right? If you even do come to church on Sunday, or watch, view it online on Sunday. But even though we listen to the lecture, we don't do the homework. And you cannot pass a class, especially a college level class, without doing the homework. You cannot live on the lectures. You could come in and listen to that teacher all day long, but at the end of the day, the homework that's assigned is important. Why? Because the teacher already has a grasp of the subject matter, but the homework is designed to give the student practices and reading that's designed to help them to be sure that they understand the subject matter. Because the principles that are being taught have to be received and understand, and all thy getting, get an understanding. And you cannot get a full understanding of the lesson by just listening to the lectures. And so then you have to do the homework in order to ensure that you pass the class. Now, what is passing the class in the connection? It's simply this. The teacher gives you the homework because the teacher knows, here it is, that a test is coming. Lord have mercy. The teacher knows that a test is coming, and they're giving you lessons to help you to be prepared for the test. And so the homework helps you to understand the subject matter and apply the subject matter in such a way that when the test comes, because the test is coming, you will have a deep understanding of the principles. You've personalized the principles so that now you can apply them to the test. And in college, the persons that struggle on the test, here it is, are the people, number one, who did not come to class. Come on, somebody, folks who won't come to church and won't log in and watch it even when you can't be there. They either didn't come to class or they didn't do the homework. That's all there is. And this came about, y'all, because I've been praying. It's so much going on in the body of Christ and so many things that the people of God are struggling with. And I've been really pushing God, take me higher, take me deeper. God, strengthen me to do this and strengthen me to do that. Give me what I need to be what the people need me to be. Help me to be the type of pastor, God, that can pastor your people well with excellence and to be that liaison to meet the need as you have given me to do. And God said, that's great. He said, but my people cannot live on lectures. They got to do the homework. And so what I'm trying to tell somebody is on Wednesday night, the persons that are connected on Wednesday night, you can even see the difference in their lives, because on Wednesday night, we're not shouting. We're not screaming, running, dancing, speaking in tongues. This is all about the unadulterated, raw word of God. That's all we're doing here, is learning the word of God. That's it. In reality, you got some people that only want to connect Sunday to Sunday or in crisis. Now I'm going to take it deeper. I want to take it. And there's a series coming from this, but I want to take it a little deeper. So then when the teacher gives you the homework, gives you the lecture and the homework, you take the notes, you do the homework. Then the teacher does not expect, come on. The teacher does not expect you to have questions on test day if you did not have questions during the lessons and the homework. Because the idea is that when you come to that time of testing, that's not the time to start asking questions. The time to start asking questions is when you're getting the lectures and you're doing the homework. So what happens? So here's how that from then to there to here and now. Here's the difference. Because as the pastor, the prophet, the preacher, whoever that is that God has called to sow into your life, some tests that you're going through, they can't be one-on-one, hands-on with you at the time, because many times that's not the time to be asking questions. The time to be asking questions is when you're doing the homework and something comes up that you don't understand. But what's happening is, for the body of Christ, is that many of us are waiting to test day. We're waiting till the test comes, and then we got all of these questions. But here's the issue, that everything that's on the test was covered in class. But if you didn't come to class, or you didn't do the homework, then you are ill-prepared when the test comes. Come here, pandemic. The pandemic has come and exposed, because the pandemic is the test, has exposed that many of us either were not coming to class, we were not paying attention in class, or we did not do the homework. And so now, in a time of testing, the preacher, the pastor, the prophet, the teacher is getting wore out trying to be all things to all people, simply because there's some people who did not go to class, did not pay attention in class, or did not do the homework. And so I'm trying to tell y'all, because this is, I got to tell you, because some pastors ain't going to tell you this, but I love you, so I got to tell you, that in this season of life, you have to do the homework. Put that in the comment section. Do your homework. Do your homework. Do your homework. Even as it relates to deliverance, which is something we're going to go into. You can come to the altar, and we can pray the prayer of faith and break that thing off of you. But there's some homework that has to be done to sustain your deliverance or walk through the steps of deliverance. Because sometimes God delivers in stages, and sometimes he delivers instantly. But either way, there's homework that has to be done in order to ensure the deliverance is kept. So you can come to the altar, and I can pray until I'm blue in the face and I ain't got no energy at all, till I'm about to fall out on the floor. But if you go home after the service and that you don't change the people, the places, and the practices that got you bound in the first place, then the deliverance won't be sustained. And the Bible says that the enemy goes to when he comes and finds the house clean, swept, empty, and uninhabited, goes to hell and gets seven spirits more wicked than himself, comes back and re-inhabits the place, and the state of the latter is worse than the former. Tell your neighbor again, do your homework. You cannot live on lectures alone. You got to do the homework. And God forbid, Lord help the people who won't even come to class. and then you think about the Christians who are cheaters, who don't come to class and don't do the homework, but when the test comes, they want to look on your paper. Y'all know who these people are. These are the people that every time they come in crisis, they ain't been praying, they ain't been fasting, they ain't been trying to hear God, they ain't been trying to develop themselves spiritually, but as soon as crisis comes, they try to make their problem your problem. So you can't get no sleep, because here they are leaning on you. They got all of their weight on you, and in actuality, all they're doing is trying to cheat off your test, because they wasn't in class, didn't pay attention in class, or they didn't do the homework. Come on here, somebody. I hope that ain't you. I hope it ain't you. All right, now we're going to move, all right, because we're still in this series. It's praying time. This is the second installment of it, and I want to reveal some stuff. I want to lay some stuff out to you, and so I'm praying that I don't go long tonight, but if I do, just stay with me, all right? I promise I'm going to help you if you stay with me. So we're still talking about prayer as it relates to spiritual growth, and it is important, you all, more now than ever, that we grow and mature spiritually, because literally our sanctification and our sanity depends on it. You have to grow spiritually because your sanctification, your sanity, and even your salvation in some cases depends on it. Think of it this way. Your spirit man is to your life what your core is to your body. And so if you ever pull a muscle in your stomach, in your core area, you'll find out how many other things are connected to that. I'm talking about, because breathing hurt, turning hurt, rolling over hurts. You understand? Many times people who have back problems and back issues is simply because they have a weak core. And when the core is strong, it affects in a positive way other areas of your body. Your posture is different when your core is strong. And so the reason that some of us have had bad posture in the pandemic spiritually is simply because our core is weak. You walking down with your head down all the time because your core is weak. You walking down with a defeated attitude all the time because your core is weak. But if your core was stronger, your posture would be better. Lord, I hear the Holy Ghost tonight. I hope y'all praying for me. So prayer, we're talking about it in terms of spiritual growth. And so we're talking about prayer as a means of communication to be a relationship, not just as a means to submit requests. Because some people think that all prayers is me telling God what I need. No, that's not what we're talking about. That's not what we're talking about in this instance. We're not looking at prayer as a response to crisis. We're looking at it as a means of communication. Okay? Now, the Bible does tell us in Philippians 4 and 6, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. So the Bible does tell us that we ought to pray at all times. It tells us that we ought to make requests of what we need from God. But what we're talking about now is prayer as a method or a pathway to building relationship. Because if the only time we are praying is when we are in trouble or when we are in need, then we are not building relationship and we are not growing spiritually. We're just not. And even from the human experience, none of us want to be connected to a person who only calls you when they need something from you. We typically block them or decline the call or conveniently miss the call because you know what they're calling for. I don't hear you at all. You lose my number any other time. You ain't call me on no birthday to check on me, nothing. But somehow you end up digging up my number. The Lord told me to call you. Which Lord? Lord of the Rings told you. I don't believe the Lord of Heaven told you that because every time you call me, you just want something. You understand? That's not a way to build relationship. Nobody wants that. So why do we think God wants that? God says, no, I need you to talk to me. Jesus says, we ought to always pray and not faint. Talk to him. Talk to him. Because when we have constant communication with God through prayer, it helps us to grow spiritually as we grow in relationship with him. As our connection with God grows, our spirit man matures, becomes stronger, and grows as well. Okay? But I want to clear this up because there's still people who look at these tactics to grow or these principles of growing spiritually as just something that we're just doing. Right. We just look at it as something that we're just doing. Just like in the scenario I just gave you about the college school campus in the classroom. Sometimes people look at the homework as busy work. I'm too busy to pray. I'm too busy to fast. I'm too busy to read my Bible because we look at the homework as busy work, but not understanding that the homework is not busy work. It's life work. It's going to build your spirit, man, to help you better deal with life and overcome the things that the enemy will send in your life. And I'm going to show it to you. So I'm going to clear this up because sometimes we don't see the value or the effects of spiritual growth because we're simply looking in the wrong place. Some of us have grown more than we know, but we're looking at a situation that we want to change to determine whether or not we've grown. We're praying and our prayer life is getting stronger, but we're looking at circumstances and situations to say, well, this person has not changed yet, so it ain't working. Or I have not elevated on my job yet, so it's not working. Or I've been praying for this house that I haven't received yet, so it's not working. No, you are looking in the wrong place. Because when we grow spiritually, everything around us does not magically become perfect, but we get better. And when we get better, we manage everything else better. I hope you hear what I'm saying. When we get better, we manage relationships better. We manage challenges better. When we get better, we manage loss better. When we get better, when we get stronger, we manage trials and tribulations better. Because God already told us that in this life, we will have trouble. He already said that. But when we get better and when we get stronger, we manage everything else better. And so when you look at the people around us, it's not that the people that appear to be strong or consistent through this season, it's not that they don't have problems, because the Bible says man born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. So none of us is exempt from the human experience of living life, trials and tribulations. It's a part of it. It's a part of it. But the people who are not falling apart, who have consistency in their lives, who are walking a straight line and are not being destroyed by everything around them, is simply because their spirit man or their core is strong enough, and so their posture is improved. It's helping them to see the world the way they should. Because when you're spiritually strong and you lose a loved one who's saved, even though there is weeping, right? Because Jesus wept. That's natural. It's a natural human response to loss. But at the end of the day, at the back of their mind, to live is Christ and to die is gain. And so when I'm spiritually strong and mature in the things of God, then death does not end in the grave, but death is graduation. The reason I'm living this life, come on somebody, because I don't want to be lost. I want to see Jesus in peace. And so here it is that many times all we talk about is living right. But we also need to be talking about dying right. Because I want we want to live abundant life, but in order to get to eternal life, you got to die. Come on, somebody. And that's not a bad thing if you're in Christ. Let me say that again, because some of y'all missed it. We only focus on many times we want to live an abundant life. Yeah, because he came that we may have life, life more abundantly. But in order to get to eternal life, you got to die. To see Jesus and get the rewards of living this life, I got to die to go to glory. Now we know that the Bible says that some of us won't die, in that Jesus will come through the clouds, he'll crack through the sky when we're still alive. But the principle is the same. That we're gonna have to depart this world in order to get to the place of reward. Okay? All right, so I want you to get that. I want you to get that. So, I really believe that one of the things that we really miss about prayer is simply this. Prayer is a privilege. It's a privilege. Prayer is a privilege. Okay, I'm gonna bring it to you this way. Think about all other world religions. Especially when you start looking at Eastern Semitic religions and ancient religions and a lot of different stuff. You start looking at these areas where in the Old Testament, God would have to tell the people of God, don't sacrifice children, don't sacrifice humans. Because there were other religions that would kill people, sacrifice babies and other people. There's still people today that do it. And a lot of these covens, these devil worshiping covens, communities, they still sacrifice some babies and stuff like that. Right? They still are right now to this day. And here's the reality of it. Here's what you need to know. I got to tell you this, because we're coming up to Halloween soon. I got to tell you that there are people that are demonic, that are demon possessed people, that are worshipers of the devil, that are teachers, doctors, politicians, and all of that stuff. Absolutely. In every area of society. And they are recruiting Christians and ex-Christians or people that don't know God to be a part of their devil worship. And they sacrifice babies. Well, somebody said, well, how would they do that, Pastor? How would they sacrifice babies without folks knowing it? Here's how. Because if the doctor, who's a devil worshiper, is a part of the coven or the demonic community, then that means that when these babies are born, the doctor wouldn't deliver the baby at the hospital. He would deliver the baby at the house. He's a doctor. He know how to do that. And the babies would be kept there. So when it's time for sacrifice, the baby's off the record. The baby don't have a social security number. There is no evidence that the baby was even born. And they sacrificing these babies to the devil. I'm telling you what I know. We getting ready to unveil some different things. But I want y'all to understand that we're on our way somewhere. And I want you to know that there are people all around you. That's why you have to be mindful and diligent about your surroundings. You have to be diligent about your connections. That's why you have to have the spirit of discernment, because it's all around us. And the devil has gotten so bold with it that he just bring the stuff right in your face. Right in your face. Somebody was talking to me the other day about they were somewhere and pretty much the person was demonically possessed and was just growling, just absolutely just growling at them in broad daylight, just growling. You know what I'm saying? It's just manifest, just growling. Nope, just bold, out in the open. And we still playing. We still, come on, y'all. And we still arguing over stuff that ain't got nothing to do with nothing. Still arguing over colors. This church is still arguing over colors. Which color we going to use this week for the annual day? Which colors we going to wear? Still arguing over seats. Still arguing over who get the mic time. And the devil is sending demonic forces to your school, to the hospitals, around your children, attack and infiltrate your whole system. But we still playing. I'm trying to tell y'all, tell somebody, it's praying time. We ain't come to play. We about to pray. Because we're going to grow, and Satan, we're going to tear your kingdom down. I hope y'all listen to what I'm saying. So I need you to know that prayer is a privilege. Okay, think about it. Okay, let me bring it a little closer. Let me bring it a little closer. How much of a privilege would you consider it to be if at any time you could pick up the phone and call the president of the United States and they just answer your phone whenever you call them? How much of a privilege would you see that to be? How honored would you feel if you had the president's personal cell phone number and you could call him at 2 a.m. and he'll pick up? Think about it. I ain't even talking about the current president. That's fine, too. But I'm talking about President Obama. If you had President Obama's cell number, and at any time, because I know some folk that if they had President Obama's cell phone number, they would wait right until they get into a big crowd of people. And then, man, let me call Barack, man, and see what he got going on, man. Let me call B.O. Barack O. Let me call old Bo, the made up a nickname that ain't even his. You ain't never call that man no Bo. Let me call old President Barack, man, and see what he got going on. And they wait till all the people get around him just so they can, so the people, oh, you got President Obama's cell phone number? Oh, you must be somebody special. Because that's a privilege to have that type of a connection. And so some folk would do that just to show that I'm connected. Well, let me take it a little further. But as children of God, we know somebody personally who is more powerful than the president. And if we call him, he'll answer. Come on, somebody. Y'all don't do this to me. This ain't supposed to be what this is. If you call him, he'll answer. We know somebody more powerful than the president. We know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the president has delegated power. He has some power, but our God has all power. The doctor is practicing medicine, but healing comes from God. Yeah. Life counselors and life coaches can give some direction. But Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. I'm telling you now, we have a privilege because we know somebody more powerful than the president, and it's God the Father. Well, somebody said, well, you said that what if I had President Obama's personal cell phone? I don't have God's personal cell phone number. Yes, you do. You got it. Jesus gave it to you in John 16 and 23. And in that day, ye shall ask me nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, here's the number. Whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, I will give it to you. God's number is his name. Lord, I hope y'all get what I'm saying. God's personal number is Jesus' name. The name of Jesus is our direct connection to the Father. Let me help you. I got to unpack it. So before Jesus comes, there had to be sacrifices of goats and bulls, and they had to go and confess to the priest in order to relay the message to the president of the universe. But Jesus came, went to the cross of Calvary, and the Bible says that the veil was torn from top to bottom, which means now we have direct access to the Father through the name of Jesus. That's his cell number. And so whenever I call him and I say in the name of Jesus, it's a direct line to the Father. Tell somebody, yeah, you know his number is Jesus. His number is his name. It's Jesus' name now. I hope you hear what I'm saying. And because, y'all, we have the direct connection to the Father, we have the personal and powerful privilege of prayer. We underestimating this privilege. And the songwriter tried to tell us. The songwriter told us a long time ago, tried to tell us, but we missed it. What a friend we have in Jesus. Listen to the words of the song. All of our sins and griefs to bear. what a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Lord have mercy. And then the songwriter didn't finish there. He said, oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. I need you to put that in the comment section. Prayer is a privilege. You can tell Jesus about it and he won't tell nobody else. You can tell God all about your problem and he won't tell nobody else. And in reality, some of the people that we go to telling our problems can't help us anyway. They ain't got enough money. They don't have enough time. They don't have enough energy. They got problems of their own. But if you tell Jesus, oh, Lord have mercy. He won't tell nobody else and he can help you. Jesus. That's what the song says. He is the only one that can help you. Jesus is the answer for the world today. But the question is, who have you told? I'm trying to tell you now, we have a direct line to the Father in prayer, and his phone number is the name of Jesus. I hope you hear what I'm saying. I hope you're getting it. I'm trying to move somewhere. So prayer strengthens us, because it connects us to our source of strength, which is God the Father. Okay, let me put it this way. I need you to understand that there is no failure in God. There is no deficiency in God, which means that whatever you need, God's got it. Lord have mercy. I'm trying to tell it and not yell it, but y'all ain't helping me in here. Y'all ain't helping me. Whatever you need, God's got it. So when we pray to God in a pandemic, understand that there is no pandemic in heaven. When we pray to God about our needs, because we don't have what we need financially, there is no lack in heaven. That's why Jesus say, pray ye after this manner. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Here it is, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Which means, y'all, ain't no pandemic in heaven. So I'm telling God to let the same economy of heaven come down here. Oh, boy. Let the same economic support system from heaven, let it be established right down here in my life. Whatever it is you doing in heaven, God, do it right down here. Because you got a whole angelic army that one angel can wipe out 200,000 or 300,000 soldiers. So I got some problems, God, I can't fix. I got some situations I can't solve. So God send the angels on my and fight on my behalf. I'm talking about prayer. To call the creator of the universe and tell him, help me. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. And to be able to call him on his personal line. And the saint said that the line is never busy. You can call him up and tell him what you want. Lord have mercy. He'll answer you if you call him. And then they used to sing a song that say, Jesus will never say no. And I remember saying, that ain't biblical. That ain't the case. The Lord will say no. Until I got a deeper revelation, I had to take it a step deeper. Because when you pray the perfect will of God, now you're praying to God what he has already decided, and the answer is always yes. Come on here, song. Jesus will never say no when you pray in line with the will of the Father. You hear what I'm saying? He will. So the way that you get your prayers answered 100% of the time is to pray the perfect will of God. Well, how do I do that? Delight yourself in him and he will give you the desires of your heart, meaning God will give you what to desire. He will start to align your heart with his heart. He'll start aligning your will with his will. He will literally impart what he wants for you into your heart so that you want the same thing he wants. And so out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so then when my will is in perfect alignment with God's will, then that means when I pray, I'm always praying in alignment with his will, right? And then I don't fall into James 4 and 3, which is when you ask amiss to consume it upon your own lust. Because I'm not calling God or asking him to do something that's connected to my own will. I'm actually asking him to do what's connected to his. And when I pray in 100% agreement with the will of God, Jesus will never say no. I just gave you Bible to support the song. All right. Now, when you sing that, that's what you need to be thinking. All right. So God, when we pray, it connects us to the source of strength, which is God the Father. Okay. So let me show you why that's important. Now, I really need you to lock in right in through here, because I got to show you what the enemy is doing. I need to show you how the enemy has been fighting us, and it's going to make so much sense as I show this to you. All right. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 6 and number 11. Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 11. We're making good time, y'all. We're making good time. Don't hang up on me. Stay right. Tell your neighbor, stay with the pastor. Don't hang up. You stay right there. You don't stop washing them clothes and them dishes. And lock in here. Tell your neighbor, lock in here. Mm-hmm. Ephesians 6, 11. You write it, I'm going to read it. Here's what it says. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That's what your Bible says if you're reading out of the King James. All right. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. All right. Now, the word wiles here in this verse is the Greek word methodia. Methodia. And methodia ought to sound familiar to you, because it's where we get the word method from in the English language, or strategy. Okay. Methodia, method or strategy. So what Paul is simply saying in Ephesians 6 is that Satan is strategic. Satan is smart. I want you to see, he's strategic. Satan knows that if I just bring something to you that's a blatant red flag, that you probably have enough intuition, if you're paying attention at all, to say, no, that's of the devil. That's not of God. I'm not going to do that. And then, right, he know that. So what he does is he's strategic. And so he devises a plan to systematically, Lord have mercy, break down your defenses or get close enough to you so he can capture you. Okay, I'm going to give you an example of what I mean. When in your spare time, I want you to read Judges chapter 13 through Judges 16. Because in those three chapters, you're going to find the story of Samson. But I want you to hear me. Samson was extremely strong, so the Philistines could never defeat him because of his strength. Every time they came against him, they lost. And they could come any way they wanted to. They lost. He could wake up from dead sleep and defeat the whole army by himself. He was just that strong. So Satan's strategy was, because we cannot come against him this way because of his strength. So his strategy was to send Delilah. Stay with me. And Delilah's job was to find the source of Samson's strength. And that's key. I'm going to show you why. So when Samson reveals to Delilah the source of his strength, then Delilah calls in Samson's attackers while he's weak, and they captured him. Remember now, this is not the first time that the Philistines had attacked him, but they never could capture him because of his strength. So Delilah was sent strategically by Satan to weaken him, so that when the attack came, it would capture him. I want you to hear that. Her job, y'all, was not personally to attack him. That wasn't her job. Her job was not to attack him. She was sent in to weaken him, so when his attackers came, they could capture him. I need you to hear me. I need you to come in and lean into what I'm telling you. Some of the stuff that the enemy sends in your life, The first thing that he sends is not necessarily the attacker. Sometimes what he sends first, many times strategically, is something that you will allow to get close to you, something that you are not skeptical of, somebody that does not appear to be a threat to you, but the intention is for them to get close enough to you to weaken you. And they themselves are not the attackers, but it's their assignment to weaken you so that when the attack comes, it can capture you. Huh. So when the attack comes, it can conquer you. I hope you hear what I'm saying. See, it's one thing to be attacked by something, but it's another thing to be captured by it. It's one thing to be attacked by worry, but it's another thing to be captured by it. It's one thing to be attacked by fear, but it's another thing to be under the control of it. It's one thing to be attacked by anxiety, but it's another thing to be under the control of it or to be captured by it. I want you to see it. It's one thing for it to hit you, but it's another thing for it to have you. And so then, we know that even as believers, because we are in this world, because of the human experience, every now and then we're going to get hit. But the key is that even if it hits you, don't let it have you. Oh, come on, somebody. And somebody think that the Lord ain't on your side because you can keep getting hit. But the reason you know God is on your side is because even though you've been hit, it doesn't have you. You have been victimized, but you are not a victim, because you know that we are more than conquerors through Christ that loves us. And even though your body may be afflicted, even though your situation may be strained, at the end of the day, your mind and your spirit is strong because it hit you, but it don't have you. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Oh, Jesus, I need y'all to hear what I'm saying. I need you to hear what I'm saying. And so what the enemy continues to do is send stuff to weaken us. That's why Daniel chapter 7 and 25 makes more sense, because it literally says that Satan shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints and think to change times and laws. Think about how the times and the laws have changed. That's why we had to pray last week for the schools, because when prayer was taken out of the school, how did they do it? With a law. They took it out of school with a law. And then as times have changed, we done removed the presence and prayer out of the school. So now we don't want the presence of God in school, but here it is. When the presence is removed, so is the protection. So is the provision. You know what I'm saying? And so now we are praying, because we're literally saying that even though you took it out by the law, we're going to pray and ask God to intervene on behalf of the school. Here it is, because God, some of your children are in that school. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. And the believers are in these situations to preserve life. And so, God, we need you to intervene, because you got children in that school. You got children in our communities. You got children on these streets. You got children working at these different places. So we need you to intervene on behalf of your children. Hope y'all hearing what I'm saying. Hope y'all getting what I'm saying. And so what the devil is trying to do, y'all, is wear out the saints. Why? Simply because he wants you to be weak, so when the attack comes, you'll be captured. And some of y'all can identify that at certain seasons of your life, you could handle stuff better because you were stronger then. But now you see yourself in places and positions, it seems like you can't stand in the face of some stuff that used to be a breeze for you. Simply this. The enemy done tried to weaken you, so that when it hits you, it can have you. But I bind it right now in the name of Jesus, and I call an end to every mind battle, every fight, every test, and every trial that's not like God. And even if it's released to hit us, it will not have us. Because when the enemy comes like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord lifts up a standard against him. And so the standard has been lifted up. And we are under the banner of the Most High God. We are more than conquerors to Christ who has loved us. So let me give you this real quick, and I'm out of here. We've made good time, and I don't want to prolong it. All right. So I'm going to give you a very quick pattern of prayer that I use to help center me in order to pray correctly. Now, when I say pray correctly, I'm using that loosely because prayer is simply talking to God. Let's not overcomplicate it, right? It's just talking to God. But sometimes when you go to God and you're talking to God, sometimes you have so much going on in your life and so much in your mind space, so many different things that are going on in your life that sometimes it's hard to pray through in that moment. So I'm going to give you a quick pattern that will help you to center yourself as you're preparing to talk to God. It's not the only pattern of prayer, but it's the one that I use and it works for me. All right. And it is this. It's the acronym ACTS. A-C-T-S. X is the acronym. X is going to help you to remember this pattern of prayer. A C T S. X. Okay. The A, adoration. Adoration. That's the A. Adoration is simply worship. So start your prayer time with worship. Because worship will literally detox you of your day. I'm telling you what I know. Worship will literally detox you of your day. So we know that we praise God for what he's done, but we worship God for who he is. So when we start our prayer time with worship, we're literally reminding ourselves of who God is. And so it centers us that no matter what's going on around us, God is in control of everything, and nothing that's outside of our control is outside of God's control. He's in control of everything, this and that. He can handle it. That's a fact. So I'll put it all in his hands because he can handle it. So when we begin to worship him, we're telling us, reminding ourselves how big he is, how strong he is, how much he loves me, how great he is. And so that worship time centers us and detoxes us of our day. And a lot of times you will find that when you go to your prayer time and get and start with adoration, you won't even get to the rest of it because you'll find yourself in the presence of God. And in his presence is the fullness of joy. You'll find him recharging your batteries at your thank you. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Just telling him, just reminding yourself how good he is, how big he is. Sometimes you won't even get to the part of actually giving your request to God, just basking in the presence of who he is. So that's A, adoration, which is worship. Two, confession. A is for adoration. C, confession. All right, now I'm going to put this here. The word confession is the Greek word homologio. Homo meaning same. Logio meaning word. Same word is what the word means. Confession, same word. So it means literally to say the same thing. Okay, now here's how that applies in terms of what I mean with confession. Because to confess your faults means to say the same thing about your behavior that God says. Listen to me. Confession. To say the same thing about your behavior that God says. Because sometimes we don't see the stuff that we say and do as a problem. Because we like it. We got our own preferences. So we don't see it as a problem. But to confess is to say the same thing about it that God says about it. So if God said it's a sin, then it's a sin. If God told you to be quiet and you said something, even if you felt like she deserved it, even if you felt like I needed to tell him this so he understand, if God said don't say it, you just sinned. So your confession is, God, I was wrong, even if you felt like it was right. You hear what I'm saying? Say the same thing about your behavior. And the reality is, if we would just say the same thing about sin that God says, it would clear up a whole lot of this mess we have in the world right now anyway. We wouldn't have to keep on fighting over which lifestyles are right. We would have to keep fighting over the difference between right and wrong if we would just confess our faults, say the same thing about our behavior that God says. You got it? So you begin, and you begin with adoration. You're worshiping God, reminding yourself about how good he is. Because you don't need to remind God. He already knows who he is. He said, I'm just trying to show you who I am. I already know it. But when we worship him, it reminds us of who he is, how big he is, how strong he is, how capable and how powerful he is, and that he's on my side. Then I confess, right? Because now I'm going to say the same thing about my behavior that God says. Then here's the T, Thanksgiving. This is important. It's to begin. The Bible says to give thanks, that it says in all things, give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. Not for all things, because when we lose somebody that we love, I'm not thankful for that. Right. But in all things, give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. Not that the bad thing is the will of God, but for you to give him thanks is the will of God. Because to say thank you means I trust you. Means that your plan is perfect. And even if something, if you did something that I didn't understand, because you see all and know all, I trust you. So thank you. Hope you're getting it. So the Thanksgiving part is to tell God thank you even for the prayers he's already answered. God, you've already been good. It's to thank him for the things he's already done, for the ways he's already made, for the doors he's already opened. And then even thanking him for hearing the prayer that you are currently praying. Lord, I thank you for the privilege to be able to come to you and pray directly to you. Because in spite of who I am, you still hear me. Oh, Lord, knowing who I am and who I'm not, you still sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. He was sinless and I'm full of sin. Had nothing to offer you, but while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Lord, thank you for the sacrifice of your son. I'm talking about now. You're thanking God. And sometimes you don't even get past the teapot, because just in thanking God, you begin to see the list of things that God has done, and your level of worship. You go back to the A. You go back to worship. You'll thank God yourself into a worship. Lord have mercy. So the A is for adoration. That's worship. The C, confession. The T, thanksgiving. And the S, that's supplication. And all supplication simply means is to make your request. Make your request made known unto God through prayer and supplication. All right. So that's where you actually put the request. What do you need from God? All right. And reality, if you follow this pattern, it's going to center you. And many times you won't even get to the supplication, because you'll get caught at the worship. In your confession, you begin to confess your faults to God and begin to confess with God your shortcomings. And he'll start talking to you about what he's going to do in your life and how he's changing, what he's requiring of you. Get to that place of thanksgiving. Sometimes you go back to worship and never even get to actually telling God what you need. But I need you to understand this, that even if you never get to the supplication, the Bible says that he knows what we have need of before we ask. Sometimes God wants you to come to the place of prayer just for adoration. Sometimes he wants you to come for confession. Sometimes he wants you to come for thanksgiving. But if you make it to supplication, that's where you put your request. So if you follow this pattern, by the time you actually get to the supplication part, you're in the right space and the right place to pray through with power and hit your target every time. And so I'm praying tonight that somebody who's hearing me, do the homework. Take this home. Apply it to your life. Do the homework. But I need somebody tonight to make an eternal decision. Because if you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to tell you that all of this stuff that we're talking about is good, but it really won't benefit you in eternity. I want you to make an eternal decision today. If you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I need you right now to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible makes it very plain. Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And today, if you want to make that decision, I promise you, this one confession, this one acceptance of Jesus will literally clean your entire slate, that all of your sins will be thrown into the sea of forgiveness, never to be remembered anymore. And if you want to make a fresh start with Jesus right now, I want you to repeat after me. Father God, I am a sinner, but I believe that you sent your son Jesus into the world to save me and to forgive me of all of my sins. I believe that Jesus came, he lived, died, and he rose again with all power in his hand. So Jesus, now I ask you to come into my heart, be my Lord and my Savior, and I will be your child. And right now, I receive you by faith and I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. And if you prayed that prayer by faith with all sincerity, right now you are saved. You are forgiven. And if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. If you made that decision tonight, I want to know who you are. Put that in the comment section. I received Jesus. Put that in the comment section, and a member of our intake team will reach out to you, get some resources into your hands. We want to help you achieve your goals in God. We are better together. All right, we're in this world, but we're not of this world. Put that in the comment section. If you receive Jesus tonight, I receive Jesus. Also, if God has impressed upon you to be a member of the Main Street Church of God in Christ, right now, put that in the comment section. I want to be a member. I'm telling you, we want you to be a part of our church family. We are a loving, inviting, and caring community of believers, and we want you to be a part of us. We are the church that loves people. We want to be your church family, and I certainly want to be your pastor. So if that's you, put that in the comment section right now. I want to be a member. Even if you say, well, I don't live in the greater Pine Bluff area, that's fine, because e-membership is an option for you, because all of our worship services, our teaching ministries, and even some of our fellowships have a virtual method, a virtual platform of getting it out to you. So you have an opportunity to connect virtually even with those who are worshiping in person. But if you are listening now and you say, well, I got saved, I gave my life to God, or I want to be a member of the church, but I don't want to put my information in the comment section, that's fine. Use that link. Click to connect. Give us your information. It will go to a private box. Your information will not be shared with anyone else. It just gives members of our intake team what they need to reach out to you in a suitable manner to get information to you and to connect with you. We look forward to the opportunity of seeing all of our new brothers and sisters in Christ and those who are now going to become a part of our church family. Tonight, I want you to sow seed. Whatever the Lord has put up on your heart to sow tonight, I want you to sow, but I want you to sow something tonight. I want you to use that link, click to give, and you'll be connected to our online secure giving platform, and you'll be able to sow seed directly into the ministry of the Main Street Church of God in Christ. Also, if you want to give via Cash App, use the cash tag, $ Main Street, COGIC. So seed into ministry today, and God will bless you for what you do. All right, listen, I'm looking forward to worshiping on Sunday. So go ahead, if you're going to be in person, go ahead and get your COVID questionnaire submitted by 12 noon on Saturday. If you're going to be in person, if you're going to watch online, and we want you to be there, we want you to worship with us. We want to see you in Sunday school at 9 a.m., worship service at 11 a.m., and YPW at 6:30 p.m. on Sunday. Listen, I see you in the future, and you look much better than you do right now. May God cover you and keep you until we meet again. God bless you, and we will see you Sunday.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn